What should you tell your children about Santa Claus?
Amen.
Well, I mean, what did we tell our children?
There was no Santa Claus.
I don't know if they ever actually, I'm trying to remember, did we ever actually have to have that conversation, or they just knew?
They knew because we told them asking what they want.
Yeah, that's true. So I guess they never had a thought of.
At school, they used to have a janitor. I forgot his name.
No, don't mention
I'm
names.
I'm not gonna. Well, whatever. But he used to dress up as Santa Claus in the school, but they knew it was him. So it was nothing. We never speak about Santa Claus. Like we never spoke about Santa gonna get you right. Or make a list. And you good or bad, or, you know, we never gave them that invitation of a Santa, and so they never, to me, I don't think they ever had any impression that was gonna be that it was a Santa, you know. And then I think when we see other kids, and then their parents might say, don't you know, we might bust somebody's bubble, and say
like
ain't no Santa.
Like we might be doing now on live television. It doesn't matter. We're talking about Christians. Now, first of all, if you say, whether you saved or not saved, to tell somebody, yeah, there's a Santa Claus and he bring toys, you are lying. Is that not a lie? That Santa Claus lives in the North Pole and then he's going to come on Christmas Eve, and the thing about it, come down your chimney. What if you don't have a chimney?
Yeah, everybody ain't got no chimney. He on top of the roof. He on top of the roof.
And flying reindeers. And almost kind of making Santa like he's God, kind of almost. He's going to be here and be there. And
he can't be everywhere.
He know what you're thinking and know if you've been naughty or nice and all that other kind of
stuff. It's a very good fairy tale. It is a very good fairy tale. It's another way of the world has celebrate like the reindeers and the snowman talking, and it's just the whole nine yards. Because I looked at Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer last night. That's my ritual. And so, you know, you just enjoy it. You know, it's
but
not
But you don't
true.
Believe that.
I don't believe it.
There's
but,
no reindeer that flies with a
shiny
nose.
But when you little, you look at the cartoons yeah, like, sure. Oh, my God. You know, you all into the celebration of it. But you don't believe it, per se. You don't believe a talking snowman. You don't believe that the reindeer can fly.
Now, let me say this. We were going to kind of get to certain holiday moments personally. Now, I will confess to this. When I was little, I did believe in Santa Claus. Don't be shocked. I really don't recall whether when I stopped believing. No, I think I can recall. But I don't really recall my parents actually saying the word, it's not one.
Well,
you know,
I didn't believe in Santa Claus.
No, I did. I believed in, and I don't recall them telling me it was, but I don't recall them telling me it wasn't, put it that way. And I did, when I was little, I believed in Santa Claus. And I believed so much, I thought, I'm talking about when I was very small. I look up in the sky and I would see. Now, looking back on it now, it was an airplane. But I didn't know it then. I would see something flashing in the sky. And then at that time, years ago, they used to have on TV, they say, like, I don't know who did it. They say, like, Santa is now in such and such. Now, obviously, I'm going back 45-plus years ago. They still do that now? Okay. And they would have it on TV, Santa is now. And I look in the sky, and I guess I believed in Santa because... You know, get up Christmas morning, and that toys, like, how'd they get there? And it never crossed my mind that my parents did anything. Now, I tell you that this is what really happened, too, and this is a real story. It had to be Christmas or the day after Christmas. The part of our house, you can look on a certain window and saw part of the roof. And I looked out there. And I saw prints. I mean, looking back on it, it was probably dog prints because a dog. But see, where my head was at, see, Santa was here and the reindeers was, this is a true story. True story. And I just believed that was the print, the reindeers was there. And then how I stopped believing, I don't remember exactly how I got suspicious, but what really did it, you know, I went in my parents' room and they had like a real deep little closet. And I went in there, this is probably a few weeks before Christmas. I opened the door, lo and behold, there's the toys. Well, that just did it. That was the end of that. True story.
Well, I didn't have to go through all that. I saw the toys right away. I didn't have to go through going through the deep closet, going, look at the reindeer. I just enjoyed it. Yeah. I enjoyed Christmas so much. I mean, I enjoyed it because I enjoyed the food. I enjoyed the late nights of me and my mother would sit up all night long cooking.
See, all night. See, I went to bed Christmas Eve. No, let me see. I was in the bed by 7 o'clock.
No, I was in bed.
Because I wanted to get up, you know.
I went to bed at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. And I enjoyed being up at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning with my mama. And we would enjoy cooking all night. And we would be tasting while we cooking. And then we get up. And then the thing about me, I never had a tree. And so my mother never had a tree. So she never had a tree or anything like that. And then it might be a year she put up lights on the window. Because we lived on the third floor. So she might put some lights in the window, maybe. But so I didn't have all the tradition of the poinsettias and the decorations and all. My mother didn't decorate the house all like I do my house. She didn't do all that. But so I enjoyed my mama so much because this was the time and my mother was a dancer. She was a soul dancer. And so we would have
fun. Is that a different kind?
As a soul dancer. And so we would have fun in the house, and we just enjoyed it. So that's the best part of Christmas growing up for me. Me and my mama cooking all night and just relaxing, and then getting up in the morning, eating the same thing we ate last night.
All right, that's good. Hey. Mm-hmm. Let's see. How do you handle the pressures of Christmas shopping for toys and gifts? Now, let me say this. Matter of fact, I think I mentioned this, was it this past week? I said, one of the things I do not miss, and that's going out finding toys for my children. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's been a long, long time since we had to do it. I don't miss it.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, you know, there were days we'd go, especially if they wanted something specific. You'd go to this Toys R Us, that one, they didn't have it, just all over the place.
Yeah, the toy that was very hard for us to get was the Big Bird.
Big Bird. Yeah.
Big Bird was sold much that we sent Mr. Pettis, his father went to go look for it. Yeah. I mean, we were like, can we find this Big Bird? I don't know who won the Big Bird, but somebody won the Big Bird, and we just went all over Chicago look for that Big Bird because it was sold out in so many places. And then Mr. Pettis said, I found the Big Bird. We're like, yeah, the Big Bird, Big Bird. But that was one of them traveling times when you're looking for whatever specific, because you really want to give your child what they ask for. Yeah. You know, you really want to give. I mean, it ain't like they don't get nothing all year long, but for Christmas, you just really want to give them exactly what they wanted. And plus, in our house, we would have a musical show every Christmas. Because all of our kids could play something. Then April always director, singer, whatever and stuff. But then Brian and the Bray would do the drums or something. It was always some noise in our house. We knew the noise. And we would have a show for your parents.
Right.
And stuff. We had shows before we ate dinner, they'll put on the show and stuff. And we just had fun. It was just a fun time because we enjoyed musical stuff.
Well, this is a special edition holiday. Let's talk about marriage and the family, but the pressures of Christmas drop. Now, one of the things we do, and I always tell people, especially if you have multiple kids, you know where your finances is. And something we always would use, and I guess they still have it today, layaway.
Layaway.
Hey.
Yeah.
I think at that time we could probably start as early as maybe October. First part, whenever.
Put that stuff in the layaway in October.
Because see, and I've been through some pressure holiday times where you out there rushing, getting it because things didn't go a certain way.
And the long
lines. And
that
pressure, oh gosh.
The long lines. And then, and see, with me is, I don't see that happening now. I'm sure it's happening now. I don't know it for a fact. But see, it's not just the Christmas toys. It's the Christmas clothes.
Yeah.
We had to have Christmas clothes. Yeah. All of my, I had two boys. They had to have a red sweater. They have to have a white turtleneck, and they have to have blue pants. So it's like you got to, look right for the holiday season. And then when it got to, when you don't have the turtleneck, you have to have the black bow tie. So it's like you got to, so it's like it's a whole celebration of just getting the shoes, sure. The shiny white, shiny black shoes, and it was fun. But I don't miss it, Pastor.
No, right. It was fun at the time and all of that, but no. Let me tell you
one time that we had a real tough, that Chris was going to be erased in our house. And it might have been when the public gate cut us off.
Oh, yeah.
And when public gate cut us off.
You all heard that story. Really, it was close to the
But it got so bad. I mean, it really got so bad because we'll believe in God. We said, Lord, we believe in you. We believe in you. And so I used to go to a thrift store. And I went to a thrift store, and this lady had a robe, and she told me, get the robe for my daughter. And I didn't want to get the robe. I really didn't want to get the robe. And she said, get this robe for your daughter. And so I got the robe, and this is when we got cut off.
Yeah.
I got the robe, and I didn't want the robe. But I got the robe, and my daughter put on the robe. And when she put the robe on, how much money was in there?
It was $300 something
in the robe.
Yeah, cash money.
Cash money. And we were like, Christmas! And then I think she got mad we ain't giving no money. We're like, right!
Well, hey, we bought the robe.
But it was like, God answering our
absolutely.
Prayer because that, I did not want the robe, but the lady said, get the robe for your daughter. And when she put it on, she came in our room and said, here go a lot of money. I said, oh my God. And that helped us. That helped us that Christmas because we didn't have, we didn't know how we were going to get the toys or anything, but it was God answering our prayer. And he did it through just a clothes that I bought from a secondhand store. So God will come in all kind of ways.
Yeah.
You just got to trust me and believe God and stuff. But that was that time we had got cut off. And Lord said, I can show you that I can take care of you. You know, you be in fear and say, well, how am I going to do it? How am I going to do this and all that stuff? But if you trust God and say, listen to God, and God can send it through a dog, a cat, or somebody knocking on your door, somebody put it in a mailbox. I don't care how you do it, God, just as long as you get it done.
That is true, because when we shared that, really, you know, it's one thing to get cut off, but right at the holiday time, it's like, oh, and that's a true story. That money was there, and we were able to do some things.
Yeah, we did ballet toys and everything, and they didn't miss a beat. They didn't even know it, but we knew it. We knew we were stuck.
Yeah.
See, we didn't have a family discussion. Say, hey, come on, let's all talk about this.
Yeah.
You ain't getting that.
Some things we talk about now. Pastor April sitting here when they didn't know they were not supposed to know these things. They were not supposed to know if we were with the hyphen over the O. They weren't supposed to know that.
No, they didn't know that the gas was off. I don't know.
I'm not sure what they really thought.
When I was cooking the food on top of the steps.
It was an electric pot, the electric.
I had an electric pot on top of the stairs cooking. And I don't know what they thought when they came home from school.
Maybe you all have to ask them. Do y'all remember that? What did y'all think? So
it was like, I don't know what they think. They like, I don't know. They said, Mama just want to cook on the stove.
Yeah, for a few months. See,
oh
we share
goodness.
These stories. That's why we can say what we say.
It was funny.
And
though.
We can relate to lack and low and nothing.
And we'll never go back.
And never go back.
And we'll never go back.
Never go back.
Never go back. Never go back. And that's why, you know, I don't even want, You know, some people get in church and they get depressed about this time of season because they might not have no money or they're lacking in some way or another. But all you have to do, every time that thought comes to your mind, you look at what God brought you from.
That's right.
You are not the same person no more. Right. And I would not let you go back. And you know, nobody would not come to me and say, when they cut you off, can I get back on? Hey, no, you cannot get back on. Hey, you better find another job. You better get together because I'm not going to let you go back.
Yeah.
I'm not going to, and we really advocate because you are, you know, you got to believe that God is able to handle every situation you are in. You got to believe that God is, because he loves me. And when you know God loves you, he is not going to have me begging out there for bread, for anything, because my Father loves me.
Yeah.
And you got to know that.
Yeah.
You know?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I guess we can start a little Q&A. Like I said, it doesn't have to be on this, you know, but it can be on anything. Those you have your questions, come
and
on down.
And this is Smorgasbord night. Smorgasbord night meaning from A to Z. Because it's the end of the year.
Yeah, this is the last one.
This is the last one.
Marriage
so,
and the family of,
so
it's of,
a,
of
so
the year.
So Smorgasbord, which means you can ask anything concerning whatever happened this year or concerning some of your weakness or strength or even, you know,
whatever. Just about whatever.
Just about whatever.
Yeah.
That you don't mind airing. Amen.
Praise the Lord.
I have a question. So, so it's obvious you guys have four kids that, you know, they grew up around the same time. Now, with me and my brother, when it came either Christmas or birthday, one kid would get maybe, well, not one, my brother, would get jealous if I got something for birthday or he didn't. So, if you know, since they're all around the same time, how did you deal with, no, this is Crystal's birthday or this is Blase Skip, no, this is not your time to not create a, you know, like you feel like you need to get something all the time or when you have multiple children, how do you deal with, you know, I guess sharing it in that aspect?
Well, I think everybody knew that their time was coming. And the thing about our children, it was just a matter of a month apart. Both girls in December, both boys were in January.
Mm-hmm.
So it was just only a matter of 30-day period with all four of their birthdays.
Yeah, and plus, I think what we did, we tried to make it like a wild birthday party. You know, and so in other words, you know, we sang bad, but we laughed.
No,
I sang
bad.
Okay, whatever.
We stayed on key.
I sang bad, but it's like it was more of like that. But we I don't know it personally. I guess you have to ask them personally. But it seemed like everybody was cool with everybody's birthday
because
everybody
knew
their birthday
their
was coming
come,
up,
and everybody would get pretty much what they asked.
The pastor would give a amount.
Well, that came later on.
Oh well, he gave the thing about this about our household. I buy the Christmas present, and he buy the birthday present because their birthday was so close together. So I buy all the Christmas presents, and he won't buy none, but then he'll buy all the birthday presents.
Okay.
You did. You bought all the birthday presents. I didn't buy the birthday present. You bought the birthday present.
Okay. Not when they were growing up. You kind of talking about later on.
Oh, well, what's the difference? They still here.
No, but you making it sound like I only bought the birthday.
Well, when they were small, you was a man. Okay, you was a man. I mean, my God, you know, you want to say you the man.
Well, let's be truthful about it then, you know, instead of saying, he just bought the birthday, I bought all the Christmas.
But you the man when they were small. Amen.
You know, we know the story, but America doesn't. They'd be thinking, I just bought the birthday and you bought the big shebang Christmas.
You the man. That's all they need to know. You the man.
All right, then.
Okay.
Carry on.
Oh, goodness.
Yeah, but that's how we bet. I don't think there was ever a problem because everybody knew their day would come. We do the same routine at their birthday, the cake and happy birthday and all of that. And whatever they kind of asked for, that was pretty much that. Even the Christmas time, whatever they
it was just like,
to
I think
that.
One year we had one of my sons wanted a certain kind of keyboard. He wanted like a expensive keyboard, a real expensive keyboard. And the pastor challenged him and said, well, if you come up with half of the money, I will come up with the other half of the money. And I don't know how he came up with half of the money. But he came up with that money because he wanted that keyboard. He really did want that keyboard. Yeah. And so he got, it's a real expensive keyboard that he saw somewhere.
But yeah, that was later on. He was kind of older.
Yeah, he was much older. Yeah. But he said, if you come with half of the money, I'll give you the other half. And he came up with it.
Yeah. See, because the older you get, gifts start getting expensive. And after a while, you're on your own. Santa Claus gone. He retired.
Okay, just to piggyback off of what Brother Phil said, okay, with me, with my children, my four youngest children, their birthdays all is in November, like a week apart. And back then, it was like kind of like not so complicated because you did one big bash. Okay, now that they're older, they have this thing to say, well, I do a little favoritism. You know, I guess with the boys, because it's like the 10th, 19th, 25th, 29th. So every week of the month, it's a birthday. But it's kind of like something a little different with the daughter.
Mm-hmm.
Would that be categorized as showing favoritism or?
What the boys think, the girls?
Yeah,
they
think that I kind of like go somewhat like out of the way for Aisha and not them. But would that be kind of like favoritism, considering that she's the only girl?
She's the only girl.
That's possible. that is the only girl. That's possible.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's kind of normal, in a sense. That's possible. It doesn't mean you love them any less anymore, but that could be possible.
It could be a healthy thing, you know, as long as it's healthy. You know, you're not going to say that I'm doing this for Aisha only.
Right.
But the thing about you just doing it is a healthy thing. Like, you know, you love all your kids.
Yeah.
You know, it's just that right now, this was it right now.
Sure.
So one, I have some history that I just wanted to share that we just found out this weekend. And then one, I wanted to ask a question. So about Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, we went on an architecture tour this weekend with the kids from the church. And in the early 1900s, Marshall Fields and Goldblatt, I think it was Goldblatt, mm-hmm. was in competition about, you know, the holiday, the Christmas holiday, and Marshall Fields had Mr. Uncle Mistletoe. And so the other, Montgomery Wards decided that they were going to create a character. So they created Rudolph with the red-nosed reindeers.
Yeah, okay.
So, and they created a story behind it. So that's how Rudolph the red-nosed reindeer started. It started in Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought
that
was pretty interesting history.
Yeah,
that, you know, great city.
Yeah.
So my question is, how do you, like now that you all have older kids and everybody's getting married and having kids, how do you continue to have your original family traditions while everybody else, you know, how do you juggle that? Like now, so say for example, I'm married now, but I kind of want to have Christmas at my house instead of coming to my parents' house, but yet we still want to participate in some of the holiday activities. Like how do you juggle, you know, the...
Yeah, well, that's up to the individuals in a sense. That's kind of up to the individuals. See, a lot of things we do, certain family traditions, you know, we create it, but a lot of it, because I grew up on a lot of that, you know, especially with Thanksgiving and Christmas. 4th of July also, too. So there are certain things we just carry and we do, and as our children get older and marry or whatever, you know, now if they decide to want to do something else, that's their prerogative to want to do something else.
Well,
you know, especially when, now let me say this, especially with Christmas, especially when you have kids of a certain age. And now I do believe, you know, when you have your own family and your kids are of age and aware of that, you should be at home. Now, I ain't coming against it. You know, I'm not saying you got to be there the whole day, but because that's how I grew up. You know, and I always said I had a wonderful childhood. Can't complain about it. You know. And I want that that feeling for not only my children that we help to do, and even to their children. So, you know, as their kids get older on Christmas, then they do carry on that same tradition of certain things with their families. They grow up, their kids with the toys and whatever they do. And then later in the day, you know, if they want to come over, if we're doing something, that's fine. But as far as when you're older like that, I have no problem with that at all.
Well, you know, the thing about this, I have always thought about that, and I said, well, I know, first of all, I guess I always knew that when other family members would come into our family that we'll have to share families.
Because you could have people who have their own things sometimes.
You already know they got to share family. So that was already built inside of me, saying that when they start getting older, when they start getting older and stuff. And I do believe, like the pastor said, I do believe you need to start your own tradition with your own household too. But for the holiday season, I prefer them to come over my house because I like kids. I really do like kids, and I really do want to celebrate my grandkids and the family all over. Maybe because I didn't grow with nobody for Christmas, I just want to be around everybody for Christmas. I just want to be around everybody.
You want but some then, cheese with that woman?
Yes, I do. And so, but I can understand if you're not going to come over. No, but no,
sure,
I'm telling
sure.
the truth.
You're right, you're
I do.
Right.
See, you see how he is. He said his thing. I'm saying how I feel.
And you're right.
And we feel
the same way about that.
I do.
But she said we prepared and we you know, and that's
I'm
fine.
Prepared.
But overall,
I'm a
sure.
grown up. I can sure. handle it.
Yeah.
But I prefer
yeah.
to have
yeah.
my grandkids around me.
Yeah. 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 Mm-hmm. Just not all day. Now, she might not mind all day, but parts of the day, hey, I'm all for, but not all day.
Answer the question, Pastor.
Now, and I'm saying that, and we're really serious on that. You know, that's even one of the reasons we look for a bigger house. You know, I tell you something. I was saying this to Pastor Laura. The dining room table can only sit 10. And I was watching some on television couple weeks ago around Thanksgiving. And I'm looking at the people. It was a TV program. And they said 22 people. And they all sitting there all happy. And I look at my dining room. I'm grateful. And I said, the time will come. I said, we're good.
The pastor want a big old long table so we can all sit together. I mean, it's the funny thing about it, every year our mind get bigger and bigger.
Yeah.
And it seemed like it just, some, I don't know how, we, it, I would think Brother Phil was over to my house and I told him, I said, it seemed like somebody stole some of my stuff. I said, where all my stuff at? It just got smaller to me for some reason. I'm like, where my stuff at? But it was there. It just got smaller to me.
Yeah. Amen. That's not greed. That's growth. Okay. What does it mean when someone, particularly a man, is viewed in a positive way outside of his home, but is not viewed as positively by his family inside his home? Does it mean he's being fake or that he is unhappy or stressed out at home? What does it mean when someone, particularly a man, is viewed in a positive way outside of his home? Well, I take it that he's respected outside but not respected in. There is a problem.
No, but you know, to tell you the truth, we all look like that. In a sense, you know what I'm saying? Because we don't go home with nobody.
Yeah.
So everybody look normal.
Well, I'm assuming the person has knowledge of this.
Oh.
You know, that would be the same as if you have knowledge of me. I'm well respected out in the public, but then not respected at home.
But we have had kids come here, kids that grew up in our church, and they tell us all nasty things about their mama and about their daddy. And then we see them like, what are you talking about? And they gave us all kinds of horrible stories about their parents. And then when we see their parents, it was like it wasn't true. So I don't know. I don't know if it's perspective or, you know, nobody know anybody at home but the person that live with them.
Right.
You know, everybody think I'm jolly all the time, but I'm not jolly all the time.
Is that what they think?
I'm in this festive mood, so I'm being jolly. No, but you know, but it's just.
Oh.
But it's all how you see things. And I understand what let's take the
well,
this
like
serious.
I said, I'm just taking it. Okay, what does it mean when someone particularly talking about specifically a man is viewed in a positive way outside of his home, but is not viewed as positive by his family? See, that's the key, by his family inside his home. Does it mean he's being a fake, or is he unhappy or stressed out at home? Well, person could be stressed out, but now based on what this is saying, you positive outside, but then within the home, something else is happening. So that's why I said there's a problem somewhere. If the person is stressed out, there is a problem.
There's a problem because they don't want to come home.
Yeah, if that is the case. Or, like I say, if there's a perception of the man is positive on the outside, but then his family is viewing him as something else, there is a problem.
Yeah. It is.
Now, does it mean he's being fake?
But the home have to be a certain kind of way to come home to. I mean, it just you have so many people that hate to go home, and then you have people staying married for all kind of stupid reasons, and then you have people that just unhappy naturally. You know, some people just some people just unhappy. You know, you can't do nothing for them; they're just unhappy naturally. So I guess you need to pinpoint if you need to communicate and ask them what's the problem.
What's wrong, yeah.
Ask them what's the problem. Why you seem more happy outside than you are here? Mm-hmm. Because obviously there's a reason why you'll laugh with everybody outside, but then you won't laugh with nobody in here. Yeah. So there's something wrong with that picture.
There's something wrong. So whether they're being fake, I can't answer, or if they're stressed out, I don't know. But there is a problem.
But you should ask the question.
Sure.
Why are you unhappy?
Sure. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. All right. Come on down. Praise the Lord. Once again, those of you who are viewing this is our special holiday edition of Let's Talk About Marriage and the Family. Praise God.
You want to talk about the Christmas Spectacular?
Well, we'll get to that before we go off. We can invite, it's not the Christmas Spectacular, it's the Spectacular Christmas Holiday Spectacular.
The pastor loved Hollywood.
No, not love. Don't say
and
love.
And so he loved.
No, I don't love.
Well, he don't love. He enjoy. He enjoyed Hollywood.
Enjoy.
And so that's why we have the Christmas Spectacular
it's
Christmas.
It's not the Christmas. If you're not going to say it right, don't say it at all. It's the Spectacular Christmas Holiday Spectacular. Thank you very much. Questions, please.
So I have two questions. The first question, what would you say is your favorite holiday memory with your children? And the second is about gifts. And so, where's the line drawn if you receive a gift from someone that's kind of expensive and you wasn't really looking for it or looking for this gift to be given, and they say, I just want to be a blessing to you, and you know they're the opposite sex, let's just say that, and they say, I just want to be a blessing to you, and then where's the line where they say, well, I'm just want to give to you? I mean, is there something wrong with giving to you? In so many words, you know, and not being funny, like, you know, no, I don't want to take this gift because it was unexpected. I didn't want to take this gift. So where's the line with that when people say, why are you not receiving my blessing? You know, why you not want to receive what the Lord has put on my heart or whatever be the case? Mm-hmm. So that's one, then your holiday memory.
Okay, let me try to answer that second one first, since that's kind of fresh. Well, It depends on, especially if it's the opposite sex. It depends on the relationship, if it's just a friendly thing. And the question has to be whether it's expensive or not, why would you buy a person a gift anyway? Whether it's $5,000 or $5, you know, because any gift with certain people can seem inappropriate, because a gift means I was thinking about you, whether it's $5,000 or 50 cents. I was thinking about you. So if that, if you don't have that type of friendship with a person where that's kind of okay and that those are things that were done in the past, then it does bring some suspect. And then it brings even more suspect if it's expensive. And in no sense are you putting the Lord in it. Unless you, like I said, unless you previously have that particular kind of relationship. So it has nothing to do so much as with the amount. It's kind of like, you know, if you don't have that relationship where this Christmas, a birthday, you buy somebody something, you know, if you had a relationship, then it's expected. But something totally unexpected by somebody seemingly out of the blue, and it's kind of like, okay, well, what is this? So that you have to kind of be careful with, you know, and especially if it is expensive, what you saying something. What are you saying? You know, so it ain't just, well, I wanna bless you. You know, folks use stuff in the name of the Lord all day long. So if you don't have that kind of relationship like that, no, it would not be right for you to accept it. See, because obviously, I was thinking about you, and I gave you. It don't matter you say the Lord.
But what if I like the diamond earrings?
It doesn't matter if it's a Mercedes Benz.
I'm supposed to give it back. Okay. I'm supposed to give it back.
All right. So you have no problem. You have no problem.
Oh, God.
With Linda buying me that $50,000 Rolex.
We're not talking about married couple.
No, you just said diamonds. I got to give it back?
I'm talking in general. If I'm not talking about no married couple. She didn't even talk about no married couple. She just said in general.
Okay. Well, inappropriate.
Oh, my gosh.
Right?
Next question.
No. Well, but I think that you know.
But she was talking like if she was a single woman.
Well,
she didn't even
she,
say if
she,
she was
didn't
a
say
married.
One or the other, but we'll take it single.
If I was single, and a man gave me a car, and he said, I agree the Lord must put you on the heart, because I need that car.
Okay.
I need that.
Okay. And then he said, praise the Lord.
Oh, God. The Lord knew I need a car. That's why he gave it to me.
Okay, you better straighten that out, Pastor Laura.
Okay.
See, somebody's been tuned off right now. I heard from the Lord. She said just what it is, and she got that car from Muhammad.
No.
And now Muhammad going to be expecting more than the mistletoe.
Oh, my gosh.
So straighten it out.
Okay, if it's not nobody that I do not want to be with, then I'll return the car.
That's a huge gift. Let's since we're going to stress that.
Oh, God.
It ain't nowhere in the world. You talking about a car. When I bought you a car, we was married 29 years. So in just buying somebody just gonna buy a car. A car?
you know what? The thing about this, she didn't even say what gift. You just picked the car.
No, you just mentioned the
car.
No,
she said you missed the car.
No, you said.
Okay, whatever. Pick. It don't make a difference.
No, you said the Lord said I needed that car. And somebody take it.
No.
The Lord knew what I wanted.
You measure it by, I said I would take the diamond earrings.
No, and you said you just
I don't
said
even
the
care.
Car.
Whatever. Let me get them. Let's just move on.
Okay, we're joking a lot, but let's be clear. If you don't have that kind of relationship with somebody, I don't care what it is, if it's some flowers or something huge, I can't receive that, because why are you taking it?
That's true.
Why would you take it? Because you obviously there's some, see, it ain't no, well, I was just thinking about you. Well, what does that mean? What does that mean? I was just thinking, but the Lord just he put you in my mind to just to buy you the. You gotta be careful with that. So you gotta watch that. Now I got quiet, but see, a lot of folks thought I knew the Lord answered my when you joking like that. That Raheem be wanting something. Best. Remember, one of the ones I can think of about, I don't know, was that 5, 6, 7 years ago, we went to Disney World. I think it was Disney World, right? Disney World. And we had really a wonderful, fun, relaxed time. Yeah, I forget how many. 5, 6, 7 maybe. And that was around, right before Christmas, right, in December? Yeah. Went to Florida, Disney World, and had a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. So that's one of the more recent memories I can think of.
Well, and I think the most fun Christmas I ever had was my kids were performing like they usually do, and one of my daughters began singing on a tape recorder. And she was singing, and she didn't want nobody to know her talent. And she got the tape and destroyed it. That was the most funniest Christmas ever. That's it for me. That was pretty funny. It was so funny.
I'm not going to say a word.
So that was a funniest Christmas of our household. That was pretty funny.
Move right along. I'm not throwing my kids under the bus. Come on.
Okay, I have two questions. Okay, so the first question is in regards to loaning money when you're not, like, let's say you're in a relationship but people aren't married. So let's say you're a woman and you're going through a hard time and you're seeing someone. Is it wrong to borrow money from the person? Vice versa for the man. Is that a wrong thing to do?
To borrow money?
Mm-hmm.
From somebody you're seeing?
Yeah. I'm just asking.
You know, now you said one way or the other. Now,
Some women might say it's wrong, and then, a man shouldn't. But some women also might say it's okay for me to ask the man and borrow money from him, but a man can't borrow money from me. I'm just asking.
Okay. To me, there's a red flag on each side. We just seeing each other and borrowing money? That don't look good on the resume.
I mean,
now I ain't coming against borrowing, but see, it's almost you exposing yourself already. Hey, baby, can you loan me 20 to the 10th?
Mm-mm.
See, you done went down a few pegs now. either for a man or a woman. If I'm seeing somebody, you know, can you loan me some? That'll turn me off so fast. I'd be here niece quick.
No,
from a woman, me borrowing from you, can you loan me?
No. I have, this is just me personal. I have tried to teach all my girls to not give no man no money. No man no money. Not a dollar, not a quarter, not a penny, not a nigga. I don't even care if he on the tollway. And he should have the money before he get to the tollway. And so, you know, I don't advocate that at all. You know, and because the thing about this, you showing me that you have no money. So, you know, that's just me personally, but you can do whatever you want to do. But that's just me personally. Now, it like the pastor said, it shows a weakness that you don't have no money. Yeah. You know, both parties.
Yeah.
Especially when you're just going with each other. Because I'm telling you, the tide will turn if he decides to quit you before he give you back your money. And then what you going to do?
And that has happened. You ever see court TV on some of that stuff? And especially a lot of women get burned. Well, I loved him, but he loved me.
And
it's
no
like.
No loan with no man.
No bank account. No
bank account. No nothing.
Or vice versa. So, yeah, that's a red flag. If you're dating somebody and, either way, it's both parties. You know, we tend to think men shouldn't do it. Well, I mean, you should. You get along the totem pole yourself. Amen. You know, you at the loan, can you loan me some money? Both ways. So that ain't a good look at all. You need some money, you get a loan from somebody else. That just.
excuse me, my second question is this, and this was just amongst my friends, but how, like, big a part should someone's past play and, like, in a relationship? Let's say, for instance, it's the holiday season and you're espoused or engaged to someone and you go over to their house, man or woman, and lo and behold, the person you're engaged to says, they point to a relative or maybe a close family friend and say, I used to date that person. And you didn't know about it. It's just a hypothetical question. And let's say it's been a minute ago. How much of a person's past should you take into account? And you know.
Okay. Now you go to the person, and they say they used to date the person you know.
Yeah, a family member or a
family
close
member of yours.
Yes.
And they didn't tell you this?
They didn't know you related to the person. Let's say they didn't know. It was a cousin or something, and they didn't know, or, you know, I'm just saying. You know, family doesn't always, doesn't always come around.
Yeah,
and,
yeah. Okay.
I mean, I'm asking too, because the world is getting smaller, and you find out that people may know people you didn't technically know they know.
Yeah, that's true. Well, you know what? That depends on an individual. Now, I'll be realistic with that because that can possibly happen. You know, and it depends on the individual. You know, if you're okay with that, of course, you know, it's gonna give you some thoughts or some things, and you kind of probably would want to know how involved were you and whatever. And that's a normal thing. So it depends on the individual. You know, if that's not a deal breaker, then you move on from it, no problem. But if it's an issue, and then especially if that relative may be around a lot, it just depends. It really depends on the individual. You know, some people don't have a problem with that at all. You know, like I say, everybody has a past and this or that. Sure, and it makes it a little bit more personal if it's a relative, but if you didn't know, and if the person really didn't know, you know. So that's up to an individual, you know. Okay. Here's an online question. How do you handle being a widow? Well, I cannot give you a personal experience with that. Only The experiences that over the years I've talked to widows, both men and women, and with any situation like that, a loss of any loved one, is you have to really trust God. And I was recently talking to someone who lost their child just a few months ago. And I said, you have to trust God. You know, you have to allow God to be what I call that divine healer, you know. And just trust him to heal you and all of that kind of stuff. And especially around holiday time, it can be emotional for some people. But what you have to do is to don't allow yourself to get into a depression or even get into a thing of being real sad. You know, you can control that. See, it doesn't, you're going to always miss people. Yeah. See, that never goes away. Don't look for that, you know, that I no longer miss a person. That's not even true. But God can heal you from the hurt, but then you have to do your part too, is don't allow yourself to get into that sadness or that depression and all of that. But allow God to heal you, and you do certain things to make yourself happy. And that's how you handle it, whether you're a widow or lost a loved one or for whatever reason. You've got to trust God. And I've been saying this for many, many, many years. People say, well, time heals all wounds. That's not true. I don't know anything about no time. All I know is the Lord. Really, because that's not true with time. I know that's a good saying, but all I know for sure is when you trust God, he can heal that hole in your heart. So I hope that helps. Amen. All right. We've got 10 more minutes, and we're going to wrap it up. 10 more minutes.
Amen.
This is the last one for the year.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. And, kicking off this question, you don't have to have lost a loved one. You know, you've got to set out for yourself that you're going to enjoy your life, first of all, but even with the holiday season. And like I said, I know this is a time where sometimes people, you tend to get sad, but don't allow that to happen. You know, do some things, create new memories. That's just like, this country, we're in a world that just celebrates death. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, it's the anniversary when so-and-so died. People go to the gravesite. People go to the spots where somebody may have died and put flowers and balloons. See, we have to stop celebrating death. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, and people think, and they don't mean any harm. They think that's an honor. But it's really, you can't do nothing for that person. They're gone, first of all. You know, so why put yourself through that? You know, don't do that. You know, start creating new memories. You know, you can't get caught up into, you know, me and so and so, we used to do this on this particular time. Do something different. Mm-hmm. You know, you're still here.
Amen.
You know, so you know, God will do his part, but you got to do your part too. You know, let not your heart be troubled. Don't allow your heart to be troubled. Don't allow your mind to get into this sadness and this depression. You know, do some things to change that. You have to do it for yourself. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when with the holidays, don't get caught up into whether you had the money to do certain. Take care of you.
Amen.
You know, one of the things we said for years is nobody can love you like you other than the Lord. Love yourself. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, don't depend on someone else to make you happy. See, because when you do that, you're going to be let down.
Amen.
Because I learned years ago, same folks who sang Hosanna on Wednesday or on Sunday will say crucify him on Wednesday. So you learn to love yourself. Nobody should treat you better than you treating yourself. Mm-hmm. Yeah. See, that's a better life lesson right there.
Yeah.
You know, learn to love and treat yourself right.
Yeah, you know, even ladies, you know, that's single, or, you know, you can treat yourself with some, give yourself a massage. Treat yourself to a massage. Treat yourself to dinner. You know, treat yourself to a new outfit. Treat yourself to a new haircut. You finna begin the new year and start a new, you know, new things, stuff. You know, make some goals for yourself. And same with the guys. You know, you ain't got to have a woman for the season, then dump her for the next season. You know, you can just enjoy yourself. You know, I really do recommend everybody to think happy.
Yeah.
Think yourself happy.
Yeah.
You know, and just start thinking about things that make you happy. And learn how to enjoy this, because, you know, when the season is over, then you got to, you really get back into your routine, because usually people get vacations around this time of love and stuff. But just enjoy yourself. I really do recommend that, because this time is so depression. It's such a time for suicide and people that's just not happy. Because when people are not happy, they're going to make sure you're not happy with them. You know, they're gonna do that. That's where a lot of killing come on. When people are unhappy, they kill other people because they're unhappy. And so, you know, I don't want you to do that. You know, you make the best of where you at, and then celebrate who you are.
Yeah.
I really do recommend that for the get past this season and stuff. And it's a good season.
Yeah.
God has joy and peace and love and all that for you. And then even that, you can love somebody else. You know, it's good for get some girls and go out with some girls, some girlfriends, and the guys, get some guys to go out to bowling and go out to bowling and I don't know what else guys do, bowling, that's all I know. But just enjoy yourself.
Sure, absolutely. Mm-hmm. All right, is there anything else? All right, come on.
Okay, so my question is about dating. So I know when, you know, two Christians get to dating, of course the man is pursuing a woman, so he makes a good impression, you know, stuff like that. But then let's say a month or two, you start dating. When does the man, or is it okay for the man to say, well, if the woman wants to, let's say we going out on a date and she wants to pay it, is it wrong for the man to say, or have that the mindset to say, okay, if you want to pay for this date, it's fine? Because, you know, most women get it twisted. Don't get me wrong. They be like, you know, hey, you the man, you pursuing me. Exactly. So every time we go on a date, I'm expecting you to pay for it.
Right, right.
And then, you know, they get into a dating for a while. It's just like a woman have a mindset. After we dating for a while, they expect an expectation from the man. So, you know, being a man that's believing 50-50, is a man wrong to be expecting, you know, a certain, like, I'm not saying, you know, out of the ordinary,
right,
I'm just
right.
saying, like, we dating now, we've been dating for a while, is it okay for you to treat me to lunch or dinner? Is that okay?
Yeah. Let me say this. Now, I'm going to be totally fair and definitely impartial with this. You know, a lot of these things are based on individuals. You know, there are certain things we say that kind of we're a certain way, but by all means, we're not making that a law for everybody else. You know, Pastor Laura said, I told my daughter, that's, she's not implying, especially your husband, don't do anything. She's not implying that. That's just wrong. So she's not implying that. Now, it's up to an individual if you're dating and if you know the tone of the relationship. See, it's not as if it's some crime for a woman to pay for that. That's not a crime. See, maybe this has gotten a little twisted and I need to really straighten this out. You know, we understand the order of God, the man is head and all that, but that doesn't mean that the woman is useless, fruitless. That doesn't mean that. You know, sometimes we put certain things that this is just the man and the woman don't have to. That's not true. You know, sometimes women look like the man, well, is he bringing this to the table? But that's fine. But he has every right to say, what are you bringing to the table? See, so let's don't ever get this twisted. Never. You know, so depending on where the relationship is at, and then especially now, any of you all know this from an etiquette standpoint, if the woman asks you to go out for dinner, you asked me. Look it up in your etiquette book. I ain't a doctor for nothing. You asked me to go out. Then the respectful thing, now if I say, no, don't worry about it, don't pay, I pay, then that's up to you to whatever. But if you ask me out, the right thing, if you ask me out, your intention should be to pay. Now, like I say, the man can say, no, that's all right, I want to, and then you all deal with that from that aspect. You know. So it depends on, but I feel the shivers from the feminine side of the room.
Well, I was going to say, don't ask him out.
No, see, let me, you know what?
Okay, I'm sorry, I'm just kidding, Pastor. I'm just kidding.
See, Pastor Laura jokes, and what happens, see, let me give you some real life, and y'all know this. See, we get this woman's root on, that's right. Right, in the public. But behind the scenes, y'all ain't doing nothing. So I didn't saw this.
Are you saying I don't do nothing?
No, I'm making a general statement.
Okay. I'm going to stop playing, y'all. I'm going to stop playing.
They could be like, yeah, that's it. Yeah, right.
I'm going to stop playing. See,
now, you know, there's a lot. I ain't saying everybody. Some women be all tough in front. Then let that man do whatever he want to behind closed doors. So don't give me that rah-rah women's lib right now. Praise the Lord. Okay. Now, once again, it depends on that relationship. And there's no crime if the woman, if she wants to, for her to pay. Nothing wrong with that. Mm-hmm. You know, and I mean this. See, maybe some stuff is kind of got shoved to the left, where sometimes men feel like they're the one that got to always do that. And that's okay. They should have their stuff together. But on the same token, a woman should have her stuff together too. See, that's how I got on it when the question mentioned about one or the other borrowing the money. It's bad a man borrowing the money from somebody you date just the same if the woman asking these can loan me some money. This goes both ways, you know. So there's no crime in that. But really, the true etiquette, if somebody asks you, say, hey, you know, then you have the intention of paying. If you don't want to pay, don't ask. Because let me tell you something now. Now, maybe a lot of men don't want to say it. Just like a woman don't want no broke man.
Amen.
A real man don't want no broke woman. I ain't saying she's got to be six figures, but broke.
And you know, prep myself for marriage. Now, how do you prepare your kids that you're thinking about marriage? Is it something you just kind of lay on them, or do you just kind of ease it on them? How do you prepare your kids to let them know, okay, like, I'm ready to be married again? So, you know, even I know, like, my kids, their mom remarried, so they experienced it with their mom, but, you know, the relationship wasn't strong with the guy. Mm-hmm. But me being a Christian young man, I want my kids to understand that, you know, I'm taking over another life and I'm bringing someone in. So I wanted to do it the right way to let them know, because I want them to build a relationship. So how, as a man, how does I prepare myself for that?
Yeah, sure. One of the things that should, I can't pinpoint an exact time, but there should be set up somewhere with your kids that they should know sometime that you know, especially if it did not work out with your mother and whatever, and some time has passed, that I do like to be married, and I do want to be married again. Now, exactly when that's going to happen, I don't know. And you know, where you've kind of already put that in there, that, you know, I do want to be married. And you use wisdom in that when that time comes, because I believe that, you know, God is going to send me somebody, I'm going to get married again. Amen. You know, and I think that's important for any family, if there was separation or divorce or anything, and there's children involved. That somewhere, I'm not saying some rush, but there's a period where you let them know, whether you're a man or a woman, that I do want to be married. And I do plan on one day getting married again. And so that seed is already planted in them. You know, you don't do that, you know, 30 days after, you know, but over a certain period, then when somebody is around, and it is important to tell them and be honest with them that this person, especially if you feel this person might really be the one, there should have been some contact already, and how they feel to a point and all of that, and it can work itself out. But definitely, they need to know. There's nowhere anywhere, and we've seen people do this, marry somebody and didn't tell their kids. You don't do that. Yeah. That's a dishonor and a disrespect.
Yeah.
You don't do nothing like that. So. Well, depend. Like I say, if certain things were kind of set up and you ask them, you know, it's kind of like I say, you know your kids. I can't tell you exactly what to say, but you use some wisdom, because you have, especially if you have several kids, some of them could be like, no problem. And then some could be a little, and you may have to take a little more time with them to a point, you know, but it's kind of you ease it in. You want to know how they feel. And it's not like you're asking them, you're letting them know, and you're saying, hey, because I do care about what you think. It's not like I'm asking you. If you say no, I'm not going to do it, in that sense, especially depending on how old they are. So you kind of keep them involved in it to a point, use some wisdom, and sure, it matters how they feel, but you're not really getting their permission, you know. All right. I believe this is the last question.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I have a question. Basically, just piggyback off Brother Derek and Sister Angie. What happens when, like you were stating, I take my sons out on dates. So you have to think about it. My sons don't live in Chicago. So my thing is, they're men. And my thing is, I'm like, what is wrong with you treating someone to dinner when you have males, or like you say, men, and even my brothers? I'm like, so you're trying to tell me that I couldn't treat my brothers to dinner even if I asked them to go out on a date with me?
What you're saying?
Remember when you was talking about that some women do not sit up here and treat anybody, or don't sit up here and take them out on dates. But I take my brothers and my sons out on dates every single
day. Did we say that? Okay, I guess I'm...
It was what, like, it was more of who should be treating whom when you're taking people out on a date. That's the reason why I was trying to figure out, is even if you like you dating someone.
What, is it wrong for the woman to pay?
Right, exactly.
No, I thought we kind of cleared that, said, no, okay. There's nothing wrong with that.
Okay, that's just trying to make
Yeah, that's nothing wrong with that.
Okay, as far as Minister Angie, it was more of a statement that I wanted to make towards her. And it's like, basically, I have been in that situation, whereas I was dating someone, and then I went to meet the family and found out that the person that what I was dating was actually a first cousin of the person that I didn't see. But is my thing is, I never had a situation because I ended that relations in general before I started a new one. So basically, I had no hard feelings towards them, but they had hard feelings towards me because they was like, why would you go towards my family? And I was like, I never knew this was your family.
Right.
So the question was, is would that be considered because I knew they his family was talking about me, basically. And my thing is, do you feel I was still wrong because I was still dating the person prior to, even though I dated one of their family members?
Okay, if you're saying you didn't know, well, if you didn't know, you didn't know. No, you can't do something for what you didn't know. You know, if you didn't know, you didn't know. Now since that kind of came up a couple times, you have some people who do know. You know, who they know that you used to go with their relative, and for whatever reason, they end up going with them too, or maybe even marrying them. Now, it just, that depends on, you know, some could say it's trifling and whatever. And I'm saying that because you have some people who are okay with that. Now, if they okay with it, what are we to say with it? In all honesty. See, that's why I say we have to be careful. You know, we could have our standards in certain things, and that's okay. That's your standard. But we have to be careful to not make it a law. You know, if a person is really okay with that, now maybe you won't be okay with it, and that's your prerogative, and you're not wrong in that. But somebody who it don't bother them, you know, it just would seem awkward. You know, I take it a step further. You could have some people went with both sisters. Now, that makes some of us cringe. But you got some people who are okay with that. Or both brothers or whatever. You know, that don't just happen in the soap operas. That happens. So it just depends on that. All right. God bless everybody. This has been a special holiday edition of Let's Talk About Marriage and the Family. Those who are viewing, we want to take this time out to invite you on Friday, December the 18th. That is the 18th, I believe. December the 18th at 7 o'clock p.m. for our spectacular Christmas holiday spectacular. December 18th, right here at the church, 541 West Lake Street. You can go to the websites and get all of the information. So we're inviting you to that. Praise God. Thank God. Praise God. This has been Let's Talk About Marriage and the Family. We will see you in 2016. Come on, let's thank God.